talk in this session will be presented by Professor Klaus Schutten from University of Illinois. He'll be presenting NEMDI results on the early science system, which is the system, the piece of Blue Waters that we have installed right now here at Illinois.
Okay, so it's a great pleasure to speak here at the meeting of Sanjay Kale. The program NEMDI on which I will be reporting would be totally unthinkable without him and with Charm++. And so it's I'm really happy to talk. On the other side, I'm really not a computer scientist. That is why I work together with Sanjay and with Jim Phillips and other developers. So I can only give you the perspective here of a user of the software, namely that benefits so much from Charm++. So basically, the use is pretty much tied to the view that molecular modeling gives us a microscopic view into the machinery of living cells. So we can simulate, just like Boeing can simulate a new type of airplane, we can simulate, because we have a pretty good physical understanding, the machines in living cells, but we do that not then build them for ourselves, but rather to provide researchers with a closer view of these machines that they cannot really get otherwise. And so you see here an example. This is a protein that is in the code of a virus that led to great scare, to great health scare a few years ago, namely connected with the swine flu. And there was a drug that was used to fight the swine flu called Tamiflu, and then the virus became resistant against Tamiflu. You see the Tamiflu as a sort of bluish molecule moving on top of the protein. And we figured out then with the computer how Tamiflu actually binds and why the virus became resistant. And so that gave us then a better opportunity for new drugs that would avoid the strategy that the virus used. But you see that you need to have a molecular view of this process of the binding of Tamiflu to the virus capsid in order to really help the scientists to develop a better drug, a better Tamiflu. Oh, thank you very much, very kind of you. So here you might have recognized in the meantime that this is where Tamiflu resides. Okay, so this is a kind of microscope we have actually built over 20 years jointly with Sanjay Kale. And our microscope is, however, a little bit different from a normal microscope. The normal microscope has metal tubes and glass lenses. Our microscope is made instead of the metal tubes of knowledge. The knowledge comes mainly from chemistry. Chemistry knows what kind of atoms, what kind of forces act between atoms that make the kind of molecules we find in the machinery of living cells. So basically, we tell the program these are the chemicals that we encounter in the model, and then the chemistry knowledge tells us what kind of forces act between the atoms. And these forces are then translated into physics, the famous Newton equation that you see there. And that's an equation basically we have to solve, though in some cases, I will allude to that very briefly, we also solve quantum mechanical equations in case that we have electronic degrees of freedom involved. Once we have then formulated the equation of motion, then we have to turn them into mathematical algorithms. And the best ones, here you see the famous Verlet algorithm, that is very simple and works surprisingly well, but in other cases we need to have some other smart algorithms, and those then of course are cast into software, and the software needs to run on the big machines. And the software that we have in order to formulate all this is the program NEMD, and it runs on many platforms, on my laptop here, all the way up to the latest supercomputers, as I will show you, as you heard it already earlier today from Professor Kalle himself, and I will show you a few more details. So NEMD is a program that is developed for a big user group. It has been funded since over 20 years by the National Institutes of Health, and it is integrated with the program VMD that I will also show you quickly. That is a program for setting up a simulation and for analyzing the results of simulations. And the NEMD program can be extended to scripts. They of course slow down particular parallel performance, but that permit the scientists outside of our own area here in Illinois to tinker with the program, and when they have then some great ideas what the program should do differently, then we can place those scripts into the core code of the program. The program is has the same kind of user interface from the laptop to the biggest computer, so it's just one kind of experience that the user has to learn. The user base is very large. We have over 51,000 registered users. We have to keep very good statistics for our funding agency, NIH. And so we know, for example, that 18% of our users are NIH-funded, and the remaining also receive the program for free, so we are very generous, and NIH is very generous there. We regularly can see when we release new versions of the program how many people are downloading it, and we have always many thousand people downloading the latest version, so we have really a live user community. In fact, NEMD is on many computer centers of the world the most employed code that runs on these supercomputers today. For example, in Oak Ridge, it is the largest used program by itself, and it's also on many, many supercomputer centers, the largest used software for life science applications. Many people are using the program. You see there are two uses for an 180,000 atom simulation that was published in Nature in 2011. And another one for 500,000 atom simulation published in PNS in 2010. And then you see just there on the bottom recent simulations that were published in papers in Nature. So it's not only a widely used program, but also the leaders in the life science field are actually making use of the program. And so it's both a broadly used program, but also a program that is used by the elite in computational biology. The strengths, I alluded to that already, NEMD definitely derives from the close relationship to computer science. So when we started, Sanjay and I, NEMD, in 1995, there were some precursor programs, but in 1995 we had the first publication on the program. It was done right away with very good software principles in mind, targeting the most modern computers, using C++ as a program language, and adopting then very quickly the parallel runtime system that was developed by Sanjay and his colleagues. Sanjay won with the NEMD and together with his co-workers the Gordon Bell Prize in 2002. We have submitted game publications for this year's supercomputing, and so we are always in competition with the best large degree programmers teams in the world, showing that we are actually among the best breed programs. It used to be that only the physicists could have bragging rights, or from engineering programs, of course, weather forecast programs today, but NEMD is right there with the best programs. It was also one of the three benchmark programs for the Blue Waters computer that we are running now. To illustrate a little bit how this kind of technology benefits actually the scientists, beyond just that the scientists have a very fast program, I show you on the next slide where one of the PhD students in my group, David Tanner, developed a new computational methodology, so-called implicit solvent method, that replaces the explicit water that is usually very time-consuming to simulate through a simpler physical model. And the calculation then of the electrostatic forces that are effectively accounting for the presence of water are much more complicated than the usual 1 over R Coulomb force that is already complicated enough. And so he needed to adopt a new load balancing scheme, but that was actually done for him by the automated load balancing in NEMD when he programmed first the one without using the load balancing. He got this kind of performance, scaling was sort of fine, but then when he added the load balancing, the performance increased enormously. The different curves here are for different size of molecules. The smaller the molecule, the less scaling you can expect, the larger, the more scaling you get. But you see that basically here was actually biology a PhD student with some knowledge of computing, but definitely not at the level of what you find here in this building. And he could utilize the charm plus plus features of NEMD to get very excellent load balancing in the time frame of a 6 month project. So this is just one of quite a few examples where the load balancing really helps totally new algorithmic circumstances and in totally new algorithmic circumstances. Here I just would like to show a few slides on the latest performances, particularly also showing how we do with involving GPUs. So last year we ran NEMD on the Tsumami computer in Tokyo, and so you see how we do on speed-wise, how many nanoseconds a day we can simulate on up to 3,000 cores. But then we added GPUs, no GPU, one, two, and three, and then you see that we are getting quite a good acceleration through the GPUs on this machine. So this is really pure acceleration. We used our best program running on the parallel machine, and then we added the GPUs to the run, and you see that program really utilized the GPUs quite effectively. We usually get improvements, accelerations between a factor 2 in the worst case to a factor 5 in the best case. So we are still working on this. Jim Phillips and Sanjay Kale are particularly the heroes there that achieve this kind of performance. Here you see the last year's latest computer, also now Blue Waters here, the Jaguar from Oak Ridge, and the XT5 processor, and Blue Waters, where we have just a small piece or fraction of the machine installed, and the Blue Waters with the XE6 Cray processor. You see that these machines run effectively, the program at very nice speed of nanoseconds a day on 100 million atom simulation. That was the benchmark simulation targeted for these machines. Now you see the more recent runs on that compare the Jaguar versus the Titan machine at Oak Ridge. And you see here that the scaling improves further by going to Titan. So we can utilize the new technology and the new size on this 1 million atom simulation that was really 100 viruses together, but not really interacting closely with each other, just for performance test. And here we have a single virus simulation to check also in how far GPU acceleration can be taken advantage of. And you see that on Titan, we're getting a very nice speed up. Depends on how many processors we have. It used to be that this 1 million atom simulation was a huge simulation for us, but now it's sort of a small system, and so we are actually losing scalability when we go to more nodes, because basically the system is too small to take advantage of this scale. And so we are getting here between a factor 4 to a factor 2 of improvement through the GPUs. And so this is of course a great benefit, and motivates the laboratories to actually add GPUs. It's a big, yes, of course, a possibility, but very little software can take advantage of the GPUs. But you see here that NMD can. Here you see the same on the larger simulation, 100 million atoms. Again, you see the difference, and we see that we are getting very excellent benefit from adding the GPUs to the simulation. So this was the metal tubes of the microscope, and now the glass lens is the program VMD that is providing visualization, a setting that is used for setting up simulations and for analyzing simulation. It also carries out many physical calculations for the analysis of the result of simulations. The visualization range is just like NMD, all the way from actually electronic levels. I will tell you in a second that NMD also begins to do electronic calculations. So here we see a buckyball vibrating. You see the electrons that are moving along with the atoms as a buckyball vibrates, and to visualize this kind of electronic motion is very time consuming, but can be done with VMD in real user time. And with all other programs, you need to run it overnight to make the turn it into a movie, then you can look at it, but you cannot see it in real time. With NMD, you can read it in real time through GPU acceleration. We can describe processes like here, the so-called good cholesterol, that is a protein that scoops up in our blood lipids and cholesterol molecules. And so we can simulate the whole aggregation of protein and lipids, cholesterol, and we can even do whole cell visualization. We start with an atom and go into this cell here and see here several hundred ribosomes. And those are machines that turn genetic information into protein synthesis, and we can then look at any detail of the ribosome. Here we see, for example, a ribosome coming here, and we zoom into it. And so this whole range of from the atom to the whole cell can be covered by this visualization program. Here you see that this program takes really great advantage of GPU acceleration. In this case, it's easier than running molecular dynamic simulations, because the computing tasks are much more homogeneous. But you see here, for example, for quantum chemical orbital, electronic orbital display, we are getting a speed up of 120 over just using CPUs. And when we calculate certain statistical properties like radial distribution function, 92-fold, and the electrostatic field calculation, very often done 44 times speed up, and so on. So we really have here a program that is really making making really professional use of GPUs. I may just point out that our first GPU paper was written in 2007, just a few months after came out, a few months after the CUDA was announced by NVIDIA, and that was possible because we worked with NVIDIA before the announcement already, and very, very closely, and could learn very early on about GPU use and acceleration, and so we were very prepared for it. Our paper, our first GPU paper, was not a boasting paper, but rather it had more than 100 equations. It really made the point that using GPUs, you have to use new algorithms. These are the new algorithms that we actually are employing. And so very early on, we realized that was really more an algorithmic perspective that we took then, as opposed to just boasting and using, you know, like easiest solutions for a particular small number of problems. You see here that VMD have many of these tasks that it carries out, analysis tasks, that are most of which are accelerated by GPU. So we have a very heterogeneous portfolio of computational tasks that that we learned to realize on GPUs this way. Here is also a particular interesting issue that you not only speed up through GPUs your computation. In this particular case, we calculate the electrostatics around this 1 million atom virus. We're getting a speed up to GPUs of 25 times, but we are getting also a power efficiency gain of 10 times. So while we speed up, we save actually power. So this is really great for green computing, and green computing starts, of course, with the algorithm. It's, of course, the computer should do green computing, but the software developer should also do green computing and do computing in a way that it runs effectively. First, of course, doesn't waste resources, and second, also use GPU, because that is then at the end even more effective than normal CPU computing. Here you see that we can do this electrostatic acceleration also on the latest generation of the Blue Water machine. So here we have the Blue Water without GPUs, and here we have the Blue Water with GPUs, and you see how much faster, how much shorter time we can do a calculation with GPUs and here without GPUs. So so we can do this kind of calculation always on the latest platforms, even before they are available to the general public. And one of the main problems with Blue Waters and with Titan and other machines, and BlueGenQ, is that they are so powerful. And that means that we are also getting more data. So these machines, from our particular perspective, gives us 20 times more computer power next year, and that means also we have 20 times more data. And that has several problems. The one problem is simply that when we run a trajectory here, for example, of a molecular machine called the ribosome, that translate genetic information in the synthesis of proteins, then we have a huge amount of data now, often several hundred terabytes, that need to be visualized. And so you have to pull this into the visualization program. And here you see that we use solid state disks to do that faster, by not just using the solid state disks as a pure technology, but also adapting the program to the solid state disk used through a new data format that we developed for the jump for coding for writing down the geometry of the atoms that make a structure like this. And so now we can pull in, instead of 3 frames per second, we can visualize 60 frames per second for this case, and for 20 million atom simulation even bigger than this one, we can do 8 frames per second, which is still good enough to visualize a trajectory in real time as it comes from a solid state disk as opposed to from a hard disk. On a hard disk, it's basically impossible to visualize it. We can achieve data rates through bunching the disk together to offer 2 gigabytes per second. That means that one high definition video per second we can pull in the data. So we have really no data problem anymore with these computers because we can visualize the data in real time now. We have no problem, however, with the human mind. Here you see a protein folding, protein called lambda repressor, and now we need to detect moments in the folding pathway of the protein. Here we have a physical analysis of the properties of the protein. Here, for example, there is shown the structure. Here are shown some other physical properties. And so we can now pull in this data, compute some interproperties of the function of time, and see where interesting events happen over the course of the folding. Then we can click there with a mouse and enlarge this one, this region, to see where it happens in the protein, and we see then much more resolved this kind of particular situation, so that we can find events on this system. So basically, until about now, it was possible to look at trajectories. An investigator could look at the trajectory, but now the trajectories are 10 times bigger and not possible anymore. So we really have to automate event analysis, and so again we are prepared already to do this. We also use the latest technology, use touch sensitive surfaces, and then also the communication possibilities of iPhone and iPads. And so now the program actually sends data to the iPhone, to the iPad, or also if we had here several people with an iPhone, they could control a visualization that could easily start from my laptop, put there, and you can then point around, rotate around, and show each other where you think some important focus should be taken in understanding the result of a simulation. We also realized that we needed to prepare ourselves hardware-wise in order to take advantage of the new generation of petascale computers. So we call that the petascale gateway that we built. And that is simply also based on the fact that we have much more data. So we have to, of course, have at least a 1 gigabit network. We are now getting a 10 gigabit network all the way to all our workstations. And here we have then also enough space to store data, at least temporarily. You know, you have to have them for a little bit of time, and then we of course need a very high capacity visualization facility to be able to look at the data. And then we of course need to analyze this kind of data. I referred to this already, and we are able of doing that actually. We have this gateway already built. It cost us $500,000, and so we are really now ready also in taking the data in. This gateway serves not only a few researchers, but it's actually a national infrastructure for computational biologists who can come and visit us and use it there for their own modeling projects. So now I just would like to give you very, very briefly, just like 2 or 3 minutes, some examples. First, VMD can also do now a combination of quantum chemical and classical molecular dynamics calculations. This is a molecule called ATP that hydrolyzes spontaneously in water. It's an important fuel in cells. And the quantum chemistry of the bond formation, in this case bond breaking of the ATP molecule, is very much influenced by the water surrounding it, so we have to do a lot of sampling to get really good data, and the only way to do that is through combining quantum chemistry for the bond breaking and classical simulation for the motion of the solvent around. And this was done by combining open atom that was developed, the quantum chemistry problem that was developed with Sanjay Kale. And Glenn Martina from IBM, they over several years developed this in the very scalable quantum chemistry code. That was now married to NMD. They load balance each other simultaneously in one run, so that we can now run effectively the quantum chemistry program, Open Atom, and NMD run together. So this is also really one of the triumphs of of CHAM++. So here is the future of the field, where we actually expect that we are in the future doing all forces that we calculate quantum chemically. So at the moment, most forces between atoms in the molecules we simulate are described heuristically through simple mathematical formulas, but we expect that we will do them quantum chemically. You see already how CHAM++ improved the scalability of a Fortran program that that calculates quantum chemical forces. You see here that one gets a very nice speed up, and one adds processors to calculation, and this is just really due to the organizational abilities and strengths of CHAM. And so I expect that in a few years all force fields in this simulation will be done through quantum chemistry, where the majority of the computer actually does quantum chemistry calculation. They get the forces calculated and they ship them over to the simulation program that uses the forces basically in a Newton equation to run the simulation. Here you see simulations that were possible through scaling by going from 10,000 to 100,000 atom simulation. We were able to solve, to describe for the first time simulation of entire membrane protein. This is a membrane. This is a protein that is actually a voltage gate that acts in our neurons and that can make a conduction across the membrane that depends strongly on the voltage that is applied to the membrane. This is really the basis for neural firing in our brain and the rest of our body. And now we even went to simulate bigger systems of 20 million atoms. This is a photosynthetic membrane that transforms light into an electrical potential. You see here an electromicrograph that was then turned into a computational model. And now you see the computational model involving 20 million atoms was done. The simulation was done on Tsubami, Tokyo, and now on continued on Blue Waters in Urbana. So a real important scientific computation that involves already the latest petascale computers and uses NEMLIT to do it. So I think I'm running slowly out of time, so I will just now skip forward to my acknowledgement slide, and so this kind of endeavor definitely depends on people, and so we have here really great people, some of us working together since 20 years, between 15 and 20 years, Sanjay Kale and Jim Phillips. I think Jim Phillips also talked here, and John Stone and Kirby van die Voort, the program of VMD, and so it's really like a particular fortunate situation. We have a very long time staff and colleagues on the faculty that work together effectively, not starting a fight and never talking to each other anymore, but we still are good friends. And that is also, of course, part of the equation to make such an effort. Without people, you cannot do it. And so we were very fortunate to have the right people here to achieve the NEMLI program that is benefiting so much the computational scientific field, particularly biology, and that will very, very clearly benefit it tremendously more now with the petascale generation of computers. Thank you very much for your attention.
I guess this is a planted question. So, are you overall happy with the Blue Water system as it is now?
I'm absolutely. I cannot even use words how happy I am, because it is first simply we suddenly have 20 times more computing, so we almost used over the last months on Blue Waters more computer time than we had available the whole 2 years before. So it's for us incredible. We are really computer time limited with all our research, and now this is of course really fantastic for us. But also Blue Waters work in practically, of course it was a friendly user time period, but still, even though it worked very, very well for us. But I think Now I have to give sort of like I really have to say this. The reason why it will happen so well is that we were extremely well prepared. So you prepared NMD on four blue waters even before the machine was there. So when the machine came, NMD was working, and it worked with just CPUs. It worked also with the GPUs. So there was very, very, very little problem there. And I think so the first few weeks we had the machine all for ourselves because none of the other codes were in the same position. But no other code picked up too, and so now we are competing for the cycles. But anyway, I couldn't be more happy than I was.
Just one quick question. If you had 100 or 1,000 times more computing, what kind of science problems are you most interested in, and what do you think you could look at with your telescope or with your microscope?
So I think I answered that already a little bit, and that is that we really expect that we can get rid of this very simple formulation of forces between atoms and get them actually from quantum chemistry. And so now we expect that we will use much of this exascale era future for really deriving the forces more exactly. And that will lift us to a new level, particularly every time we have some special chemical situation, for example, involving metal atoms or metal ions, then we run totally out of steam with our primitive approach because these electrons are quantum chemically dominated. They can only go in certain directions, for example, tetrahedral directions, not like spherical directions, what the program assumes now. And so anyway, so we have we really can lift our field to much to more Lebesgue, to material science quality computation with the ability to quantum chemically derive our forces, but that will really eat up that factor 100 or 1,000.
So obviously you're familiar with the stuff going on at DE Shaw where they basically build a machine to do only one thing, to do only one force field. I guess this is sort of stealing Pete's question from earlier, but they're sort of over here and you're obviously running on everything. Is there a set of functional units or a set of primitives that would make NAMD run, you know, 10 times faster without really upping the juice, or you know, can you put in another type of, in addition to an FPU, that would make magic happen, or do you really have to sort of evolve the whole processor in every direction for NAMD to run faster?
So that is a very timely question. So the answer is the following. So we work also on Anton. Shaw made some of the machine available at the Pittsburgh Supercomputer Center, so we ran extensively there. And so Anton is a completely is a machine completely dedicated to only molecular dynamic simulations. And so it is really 100 times faster. It's really wonderful. We can do longer simulations, and very essential because many biological processes are really millisecond processes, and with blue waters also we can only reach like 10 microsecond times. We cannot get more. And the reason is that parallel at this stage is only helping us to describe bigger systems, not to do anything faster. So we can calculate about 200, 300 nanoseconds a day of real time for a molecule, but we cannot go beyond it. And the reason is basically that with the computers that Cray and IBM at the moment, still in the future probably not anymore anything, sells us, they are limited basically to physical measurements. The computing step is now about a little bit below a millisecond, and we cannot make it faster because there are too many delays in the communication network of the machines, even if they have even faster communication bandwidths. And so we have to use a machine of the Shaw type, but I don't know if the companies know how to build them. So these kind of parallel machines allow us to do something very exciting, to go to larger biological systems as we find them in living cells. but it doesn't allow us to become faster. We would love to become faster. I beg Sanji almost every day, but he tells me the laws of physics. I know the velocity of light. I know how fast a transistor can respond. And so I have to just agree with him that he is where he can get, and he cannot get much faster, except if we are making machine much more tightly integrated like Shaw did. But that can, at this point, probably only be done for a special, real, extremely special purpose machine. One could debate this with Cray, and I every time I see anybody from the company higher up, I tell them that why do you sell out this machine that is not doing something faster? But Monita debated with real top engineers that they may be able to give us a faster machine. So this is really, for many scientists, particularly in my field, a big problem that we can do. The power is only in the size, but not in the speed.
So let's thank our speaker.